Welcome back. You're still watching Citizen Extra, the Friday edition with me, Freddy Ndimuli. Before we continue our discussions, let's take live pictures. We do understand guests and senior politicians and officials are joining mourners and friends as well as relatives of the late Gigi Kariuki, the senator for Laikipia, who's said to be buried today. Those are live pictures from Rumuruti of the arrivals. Quite a number of people there are arriving by chopper. Pictures there from Rumuruti in Laikipia, where mourners continue to arrive for the burial of the late senator for Laikipia County, Gigi Kariuki, who is set to be buried today. Of course, among the mourners set to attend that burial is President Uhuru Kenyatta. We'll continue updating you on events from that end. Our reporters are there on standby. Back in studio, still have Bwana Brian Weke and Dr. Sam Kamau, and we're now joined by Bonke Komwai. I'd like to thank Onchari Oyeyo, who has left the set. Now Bonke Komwai takes his place. Karibu sana Bwana Bonke. Just before the break, we were talking about political intolerance, and probably let me give you an opportunity to speak on that before we move on to this appeal by the IEBC. Of course, Bwana Bonke Komwai, you've seen the number of instances this week where politicians have been heckled during rallies elsewhere. Some politicians have encountered hostilities that have bordered on chaos. Case in point, yesterday, where the police had to use tear gas to disperse rowdy youth as NASA leadership visited Murang'a and parts of Kiambu County. What do you say to that?
Thank you, Ndimuli, for having me this morning. Well, it is quite unfortunate in the 21st century if some politicians can pay some hooligans to heckle at our national leaders or any other leader, political leader. What happened to Right Honorable Raila Odinga and Thika yesterday was quite unfortunate, and the same happened in Baringo. And we witnessed what happened to President through his deputy in Kisumu the other day. I think Honorable Ole Kaparo should now come out very clear to tell us why we are paying him salary. Because this is the reason as to why Honorable Ole Kaparo is in that office. Recently, he launched some gadgets to investigate these politicians who are paying hooligans to heckle at some other leaders. Because if Raila goes to Kiambu and youths are heckling at him, this shall be the genesis of violence. And Uhuru goes to Kisumu, then some people start singing some songs which are now sending some funny messages to even to the international community. There must be an individual who is paying these hooligans to heckle at our leaders. So Honorable Ole Kaparo should do investigation, because he has an access through NSIS. He can access each and every leader's phone call to know the M-Pesa transaction, the communication these people are having, because no one can wake up in the morning like these youths. They can't just wake up in the morning and they go to a political rally just to heckle at somebody without anybody fueling or buying them some cheap alcohol. So there must be somebody behind it. And Ole Kaparo should respond to this within 24 hours to tell us who are behind Kisumu incident and what happened to Raila and Thika and also in Baringo, because we cannot continue like this. If our maybe the opposition leaders, they go to Jubilee stronghold and these youths are heckling at them. I mean, it's really sending a very dangerous message to Kenyans.
And would you think, apart from, let's say, NCIC, don't you think the political leaders also have a role to play that, yes, if at all they could come up and speak out at the national level, that probably these cases will just die down?
Well, this is a personal, it's a personal decision. You know, there are some loyalists, maybe by sending youths to heckle at maybe an opponent of his political leader, maybe that is how he's showing his loyalty to the party. You know, politicians, you cannot trust them. Not all of them can observe decorum all the time. Some are just sycophants. They are not even leaders. So there is possibility for a politician. Mm-hmm. These politicians, they are not trees. They are individuals. They are beings. They are the ones who are paying these leaders. So you cannot trust politicians with issues of peace. I mean, it's their responsibility, yes, and they know very well that if they come on Citizen TV and start talking harshly or negatively on a certain community, they will be arrested. So what they will do, they will use poor youths to attack these leaders. So they have to be investigated and they must be arrested.
Okay. Let's now move on to the issues of the IEBC appeal against a ruling that cancelled the ballot paper printing tender. Now, the spotlight is on the judiciary today, which has unveiled a five-judge bench. And I do have the names of those judges. Erastus Givenji was the presiding judge. Rosalind Nambuye, Al-Nashir Viswam, Jamila Mohammed, and Professor James Otieno Odek. They are, of course, handling the appeal by IBC against cancellation of the presidential ballot paper printing tender. The session is currently underway. The Court of Appeal, let's listen in.
Yes, boldly and confidently on a correct interpretation of Article 10 as read with the other party.
But that the participation of the people is necessary, and you said that is done through the leaders.
If it is necessary, it
so those leaders you are talking about, could yes. I assume they are members of parliament who they have elected?
Yes. My Lord, yes.
The people express their views.
Yes.
What we're talking about participation through the parliament.
Yes.
So people participation happens through the parliament.
Exactly.
Public participation happens, as you put it, in fora that are organized.
Yes.
But in this case, it is not necessary.
No.
Especially with regard to direct procurement. That's your case.
That's my case. In fact, my Lord, you will find uncontroverted evidence that when Agure was being procured directly, the Electoral Commission went to Parliament, made a committee of Parliament where members of Parliament were.
We do apologize for the poor signal from the Court of Appeal. That's the Court of Appeal there, and lawyer Paul Mwita representing one of the sides in the appeal filed by IEBC against the cancellation of the presidential ballot paper printing tender. Now, that appeal is being heard by a five-judge bench comprising Erastus Givenji, Rosalind Nambuye, Al-Nashir Viswam, Jamila Mohammed, and Professor James Otieno Odek. Now, gentlemen, without even going into, because this matter is before court, without going into the merits or demerits of the case, just looking at the composition of this five-judge bench, of course, I'm sure it must be one of those things that people are talking about now, given the kind of criticism, the kind of allegations made last week against members of the judiciary, accusations that some of them are related to another one side of the political divide. Now, how easy or hard or difficult do you think it was for the Chief Justice to actually constitute such a bench? Brian?
I think for me, that is not the question. Whether who constitutes the bench, how the Chief Justice chose the bench, I think for me those are immaterial procedural issues. For me, the key issues which we need to deal with as a country is we are now nearly 3 weeks to the election, and the court has actually pronounced itself on the issue of ballot papers. Fred, let me just explain to you the procedure. You remember initially IBC had allocated the contract for printing of ballot papers to Al Ghurair. NASA went to court to challenge the procedure and the award of that particular contract, and the court nullified that particular tender. When IBC went back and the new commissioners had just checked in, they opted to go for what is called direct procurement. And in their direct procurement, they still went ahead and awarded the contract to the same organization, which is Al Ghurair. Now, of course, NASA, as well as other presidential candidates, went to court to challenge the award of, again, that particular tender. And you can see clearly, if you ask me, because you know, when you look at political processes and issues to do with confidence in the commission, it is not only reality but also perception. The questions that even Kenyans are asking ourselves: what is the motive of pushing this agenda for Al Ghurair? Why is IBC going to appeal that particular decision? Mm-hmm. The court is very clear. It said, well and good, all these other positions have already been printed. Can you get a different printer,
okay,
to print the presidential ballot paper? So the question we're asking ourselves: what is the motive? Why is IBC, and because of time, why are they still pushing for the Al Ghurair to be given the contract?
Okay.
And you see, those are perception issues, Fred, that make Kenyans extremely worried.
But Brian, when it comes to perception, this issue that you say is immaterial about the naming of judges came up last week on political platforms, and yes, even the selection of a three-judge bench was still criticized by one side of the political divide. Don't you think that even the ruling from this, probably people might start looking at who sat on the bench as well?
I think we have institutions, Fred, and all these judges, they come from different tribes. All these judges, they have their own leanings, whether political, philosophical, or any other sort of leanings. So if we start questioning the judiciary based on the decisions they've made, based on where somebody has come from, I think we are losing it.
Yes.
And we, again, issues, it is the judiciary. If you do not like the position, for me, and that's why I don't want to look at where does Nani come from, this judge, why was he appointed, you know, it is the judiciary, and it is the arm of government that actually checks both the executive and the legislature.
Okay.
So for me, let us give our institutions the benefit of doubt.
Bonke Komwai, on occasion you've spoken and appear to speak for Jubilee. It's Jubilee that really criticized the judiciary on the naming of judges to preside over some cases. Don't you think that even this one could be subject to that as well?
Well, as far as this question is concerned, I would give my view as an analyst, though I'm in Jubilee, but I don't want to appear as a sycophant. I want our politicians to know that judiciary, it's not a limited company or a political party. Judges cannot be intimidated, and they don't work under instructions. So if you cannot agree with the judgment, I mean, that's up to you. I want to advise our fellow political leaders, if you want your interest to be represented, because I'm trying to look at it from political perspective, send some senior advocates in court to represent your issues. Because if we keep on attacking judiciary on a political rally, I mean, we are going to lose it, or they are going to lose it big time. Another thing, Chebukati should also win the interest of Kenyans. If he keeps on speaking the same language with politicians, then who is going to trust him on 8th of August or whichever, I mean, by the time he's going to give us the final results? If he feels that he's working under a lot of pressure, there is still time for him to resign so that somebody can take, I mean, the position he is in. What we are working on right now is that the issue of presidential papers. Now, if the current case which is going on in court right now maybe may go against him or against the IBC, what will happen?
Mm-hmm.
Which we don't want to predict, because it's unconstitutional. My brother Weke here is a lawyer, he can advise us. So Chebukati should adhere to the court ruling. I think there is still time. If there is no money, if they don't have money, then they should come out very clear that his institution does not have enough funds so that the government can fund them. I mean, getting a company to print these papers, I don't think it is an issue. Even if they can give me as a broker, I can go outside there to look for a company to do that. I offer myself to broker that deal.
Okay, only last week you appear to be a mouthpiece for Jubilee, now you're a broker.
No, I'm saying if they don't have time to go to Dubai or to China or to Sweden to look for a company, I do offer myself, I can do that work at a fee.
Okay.
I hope that you're getting it, huh? Bonke is a broker for Jubilee.
Not a broker for Jubilee, I'm saying on this matter of presidential papers, because Chebukati is complaining that he doesn't have time to process all this. But there is still time. Within a week, we can get these papers in order if there is money.
Okay, and I'll come back to that conversation about the nitty-gritties to do with the ballot printing. But Dr. Sam, come on, I want to give you an opportunity to also comment on this issue of constituting a bench to hear a particular case that was really criticized on political platforms only a week ago. Now we have a new judge listening to cases that are still related to those ones that were being criticized. Don't you think that this could also end up on the political platforms as well as a matter of discussion?
Well, I can assure you, Fred, these political realities are weighing in heavily on the minds of the five judges and even the president of the Court of Appeal, even as he constituted this particular bench. But it was very unfortunate that they were on a political platform, they decided to single out one particular judge and of course they brought in the issue of ethnicity in a sense, or even the issue of his relatives. That was very unfortunate, because over the last 4.5 years we have developed a culture of attacking our institution. In a sense, it's an effort or an attempt to delegitimize. We have done that to the IEBC, we've done that to the NCIC, we've done that even to Parliament, to the presidency itself, and to the judiciary. And I think we have seen the consequences of some of these things. And I think it's really bad. We have actually to trust the institutions that are put in place through legal mechanisms to actually serve our interests. Having said that, I agree, there's a sense in which I said that the political reality of what the judges are dealing with is weighing heavily on them. We saw, of course, previously that NAS also made some strong statements, expressed strong sentiments in regard to a matter that was before the judges. While we agree, of course, that they should not be intimidated, I know this reality plays an important role in their mind. Subconsciously, it's weighing in heavily on them because they understand the implications and the weight of the decision they are going to make. But for me, I think the issue is not even the composition of the judges. It is what this appeal means, what this case means, if it goes through or if it does not go through. And I think this points more to IEBC and what it means for them. I think IEBC should still continue planning and preparing to deliver an election on August 8th. Whatever happens as a result of this case, they simply need to adjust and comply with the ruling. If the appeal goes through, then IEBC will go ahead and Algeria will deliver the papers. If the appeal does not go through, I think IEBC already has a parallel process where they are receiving views from members of public, and I am sure they have a plan in place, and I think that is what they need to do. I think we understand by now that every time IEBC overcomes one legal hurdle that is placed ahead of them, the other one comes up. Yes. And I think they must focus on preparing for the elections and deliver a credible election. But I think we must resist from this culture of always, you know, we have this habit as Kenyans, when we are looking at an issue that affects the nation, we look at the names of the people who are involved. If it is a bishop, when he speaks, you listen to what he is saying, then you look at his name and see whether the name betrays or it relates to the sentiments that he is making. It's a really bad thing in a highly ethnicized country, and like we are saying, we have to get to a place and respect that people can act as professionals in respect to the offices that they hold and not always respond to their ethnic sentiments.
Okay, let's now take a look at the actual ballot printing. And it should be noted that despite the ruling last Friday, it did not in any way bar Al Ghurair from printing papers. So the fact is, IEBC, if as long as it complies with the public participation requirement, it can still go ahead and re-award that tender to Al Ghurair. Brian, do you think that that could cause problems? Because it appears, because of time, Al Ghurair already were prepared to go ahead and print. Don't you think that that's the automatic best option to go ahead and continue the job?
I think with the strictest means of the text as provided for in the ruling, nothing stops them from awarding the tender again to Al Ghurair. However, as I've told you, Fred, these political processes, managing of elections, and elections such as this one, where it is very close, issues to do with perception and the issues to do with confidence levels are extremely important. So if I was a commissioner, and I want to tell you this without fear of contradiction, if I was a commissioner at IEBC, and there are serious players who have credibility issues with the printer, why focus on giving that particular printer? Because again, it can be misconstrued or construed to mean that you are actually working for a particular side. If you ask me, IBC ought to focus on awarding this contract to a different organization. And if you ask me, let us work with printers that have printed in the UK, printers that have printed for serious jurisdictions that practice democracy. And I think that in itself will create a lot of checks and balances. That in itself would give confidence to different players within the electoral process and the entire public. You can imagine, Fred, this issue of Al Ghurair has been there for a long time. And people, there is a certain people who feel that Al Ghurair is close to some players. So if you ask me, they ought to make an independent decision. I've heard them talking about the 7 security features. Create them. How long does it take to create those 7 security features? You're only doing ballot papers for president. So if you ask me, even these issues of appealing, why is IBC appealing? If the court says there is an issue, and let me tell you, the court had wisdom, even though they dismissed a number of issues, when they made the decision to cancel that particular tender, they know, and there is a wisdom in that particular ruling. Yes. So let IBC sit down with the different players and retreat and make a decision and appoint a proper printer to print the the ballots for the president.
But looking at the ruling, Bonke Kumwai, there's no place that it says Al Ghurair cannot be awarded this tender. The only issue that the court raised was public participation, in as far as the tender was awarded the last time, and that's why it was stopped. But surely, even Al Ghurair would argue that they do have a right to tender for the process as well, don't you think?
Well, you see, the problem is that, remember when the opposition started this propaganda of Al Ghurair, this is how they are related with the president family. One of President Uhuru Kenyatta's brother is one of the directors at, with the, whatever Lugard, the company. And now, that gave the public a different perception, especially NASA loyalists. So even if this tender can be rewarded back to Al Ghurair, I mean, it will still give us, I mean, NASA, I know they will never agree. Raila will not agree. He will never agree with the court or whoever or the IBC for this company to be rewarded the tender again. So for Chabukati to win the interest of the public or also the trust, I think this thing should be just awarded to another company. Then we involve two parties. Now that is now the NASA and the Jubilee Coalition, and the public to participate. So whichever company will win this tender can be given this, because this is the public. It's the public interest. So we cannot insist and dictate. Another thing, these offices like now the IBC, they need some political minds. In fact, all the time, if you always think legally, this is where now the problems comes in, because right now people are asking, even the analysts, why is the chairman of IBC, he keeps on going to court to be...
You think the IBC should consider someone else away from Al Ghurair?
Oh yes, they should. They should. They should do that. And actually, Chabukati should take some political decision now.
Remember, it's only 3 weeks. It's slightly more than 3 weeks to the elections. Dr. Sam Kamau, do you think we can continue this process? Because surely, I'm sure Al Ghurair must have all the must be ready to go out and print.
If you listen to Brian and Bonke, they are agreeing or admitting that it's not necessarily the legal issue here. Brian is talking about perception, although you also have to ask whose perception. But I think we are not questioning the ability of Al Ghurair to deliver ballot papers. I think that is not the question. And even as you have correctly pointed out, the ruling did not address itself to that. It's just an issue of public perception that you are dealing with here. Now we have to look at the reality. There are the decisions that have been made by the court, but there is also now the logistics. And you know, for IEBC, and what we have seen is that it's a logistical nightmare to plan and organize an election and deliver a credible one at that. I am very sure they are looking at the easiest way, of course, which was to appeal, because if the appeal goes through, then they will just go ahead as they had planned, and this does not disrupt their plan. But on the other hand, they are alive to the reality. And if you have looked at the history of the court decisions, the courts have always favored the petitions that have come before them. IBC has lost quite a number of these, and I am sure they also anticipate a likelihood or a scenario where they can lose this particular appeal. So they are putting, I'm very sure they are putting measures in place, because you saw they extended the period for receiving memoranda from the public and receiving views of the possibility of picking, or I mean the process of picking, if they were to pick a different or pick a new supplier. But if you look at it, I understand from a logistical point of view, it's a nightmare of course going back to the process of again planning, because it's not just delivering the ballot papers, it's actually how they will be distributed, is the packaging and how they are brought together with the others. I agree, of course, we want a process where everybody agrees. But what we have seen when we talk about public perception, if one side of the political formation, for example, CORD, when they were CORD, when they questioned the decisions of IEBC in 2013, there was a feeling that half of the country did not support IEBC. When they questioned the decision of the Supreme Court, again, there was that feeling that half of the country. So when you talk about public perception, is what one major political formation says today about a particular matter. For example, if today Jubilee says they do not have confidence in a particular player or in a particular media house, that is how their supporters will start talking about. So in terms of satisfying and fulfilling the demands of what you are calling public perception, it depends more on the political players. And like my colleagues have suggested, I'm uncomfortable with that. But listen to the views of both NASA and Jubilee as far as this matter is concerned. But IBC must still retain its independence in doing its work and make a decision that will make sure we have an election on August 8th. The other thing is, all these hurdles that are coming up, I have a feeling they are setting us up for a long protracted battle at the Supreme Court after the elections, because you will see so many hurdles, things that were not fulfilled or met, and I think we will actually have a contested outcome if things continue the way they are.
Do you agree that IBC should consider someone else away from Al-Ghurair for the printing of presidential ballot papers?
Well, not necessarily, but if the courts address themselves to this and they lose their appeal, of course I am very sure in their internal meetings they are already considering that possibility, but I wouldn't say that is necessary.
Because even if they lose their appeal, they could still give this tender to Al-Ghurair.
Absolutely, and they can go ahead and do that. Personally, I am saying, I know even after this matter of ballot papers goes away, something else will come up, and IBC will still have to address a new legal hurdle. And that is why I'm saying their business, their job, is to prepare for an election on August the 8th. Just make your plans. But if the courts come and pronounce themselves on a matter that makes you deviate slightly from your plan, you make the adjustments and move on.
Yes, of course, the Court of Appeal, a five-judge bench, has been unveiled, comprising Erastus Githinji, Roselyn Nambuye, Al-Nashir Viswam, Jamila Mohammed, and Professor James Otieno Odek, to listen to that appeal by IEBC against a cancellation of the presidential ballot paper printing tender to Al-Ghurair Company. The appeal is currently underway at the Court of Appeal. I will continue giving you updates from that. We need to take a break now. When we return, we'll be discussing matters to do with IEBC's preparedness for the elections. Yesterday, the headlines of the dailies were awash with some of the issues raised in a KPMG report with regard to the loopholes or possible loopholes in as far as taking care of the voters' role is concerned. Has IEBC been able to handle this the best way in as far as building public confidence in its ability to handle these issues? But that, when Citizen Extra returns.